And I will call Mr. Davis.
President, my question is to the Attorney General. I refer to the 149 former foreign detainees, 37 of whom were sex offenders, and some of whom have been knowingly released by the federal government into Victoria. Attorney, I ask very simply, were you informed in detail by the federal government about the 40 detainees who were released into Victoria? And if so, how and on what date?
Minister?
Thank you, Mr. Davis, for his question. No.
Mr. Davis with a supplementary.
And I ask the Minister, therefore, can you inform the House how many of these 40 foreign detainees released into Victoria are criminals?
Minister.
Mr. Davis, I don't have that information, but as you have outlined in your question, this is a matter for the AFP, and they consult heavily with VicPol in the management of any of these types of issues. And in my role as attorney, there is limited crossover.
Dr. Ratnam with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Housing. 26 Dunlop Avenue, Ascot Vale, forms part of the government's public housing renewal program. This was public land where no public housing was rebuilt and where residents in the private housing are already starting to experience significant problems. Grace Bell, a resident, has found that her brand new affordable home has a plethora of problems, including mould growth, dampness, cracks in the roof, and tap water that may be unsafe to drink. Grace's housing provider has ignored every request for these issues to be rectified, and Homes Victoria made thinly veiled threats about Grace's housing tenure. This has left Grace with no choice but to move to an Airbnb and pursue the matter in VCAT, creating significant stress for Grace, who lives with a disability. Grace reports that her neighbours are facing similar issues but are too afraid to raise the matter with their housing providers for fear of eviction. Minister, will you intervene and rectify the issues at 26 Dunlop Avenue, Ascot Vale?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Dr. Ratnam, for that question. I'm not familiar with the details of the matter that you have raised. Again, as I've invited members in this place and indeed your colleagues in the other place to do, I'm very happy if you want to approach me directly. As the matter is before VCAT, I'm not going to make any comments in relation to the progress of that matter. That shouldn't come as any surprise to you, Dr. Ratnam, for us to see to intervene in a proceeding that you've brought to this place with what can only be an incomplete picture of events and assertions made by you and not directly by the person involved means that it would be at its highest irresponsible of me to be making commitments in the terms that you're seeking before the Chamber today. Dr. Ratnam, if you do have general matters that you wish to raise rather than what appears to be a very broad brush approach to concerns held for other residents, then please feel free to talk with me about them rather than saying that you're seeking an intervention in a legal process currently on foot.
Dr. Ratnam, supplementary.
Thank you, President. Thank you, Minister, for your response. I'm surprised that you haven't heard of the issues at Ascot Vale because we've heard from a number of residents who are having very similar issues, and I thought you all would be monitoring the situation quite closely. Grace's situation is showing us what happens when private developers are left in charge of housing vulnerable and low-income people. She was turned away from the housing registrar, who says affordable housing does not fall under their remit, Homes Victoria. The National Affordable Housing Consortium, the tenancy manager and the estate agent have all failed to support Grace. They've passed the buck or simply ignored her. We've already heard from many public and community housing residents that the dismal state they're being left in due to a backlog of maintenance requests. And now it seems these issues are plaguing affordable housing tenants too. If this is the future of affordable housing built around the state, we should all be very concerned. Minister, you failed to release the Social Housing Regulation Review and the government's response 2 years after it has been completed. And while we wait, residents are falling through the cracks. Minister, which body is responsible for holding affordable housing providers to account?
Minister.
Thank you, President. Dr. Ratnam, I find it curious that the preamble to your supplementary question goes on to allude to the fact that or to an assertion that Homes Victoria is not responsible for the particular matter that you have raised here. And I would seek, out of an abundance of caution, that you're aware of the way in which the housing portfolio operates and the work that is undertaken within this portfolio. Affordable housing, and again, I can't speak to the matter that you have raised because you haven't provided me with sufficient detail to be able to do so on my feet, and it would perhaps have been a better use of your time to approach me before this particular process in question time to actually talk about the fact that affordable housing is covered by a range of different portfolios. There is an element of affordable housing within the social housing portfolio for which I'm responsible, but I can't say whether it falls within this portfolio or not. Again, really happy to take this offline and perhaps make a bit better use of the time that you've got here in the chamber.
Minister Shing, Minister's statement.
Thank you, President. I rise today to honour two exceptional members of our communities. The late Natalie Raby was chair of the Ashburton, Ashwood and Chadstone Public Tenants Group, who sadly passed away 2 weeks ago. Since 2005, this group worked really hard to represent the needs of local renters, providing free advice and assistance, and running the popular annual event Public and Proud, which brought public housing community members together. In 2017, Natalie and the AAC Tenant Group won the Francis Pennington Award for Social Housing Volunteering. Natalie was also a long-time board member of the Victorian Public Tenants Association, sat on the board of several neighbourhood houses, and frequently participated in broader public consultation, including the recent statewide Public Housing Consultative Committee for public housing residents. Natalie was dedicated in her advocacy for public housing tenants and community involvement, and she'll be remembered for her tireless efforts to help those in need. My condolences to all of her family, friends and colleagues, and indeed the broader community, and those who were touched by Natalie's advocacy and passion throughout her life. In the equality portfolio, President, I rise to pay tribute to the late and wonderful Phil Carswell. Phil passed away on March the 17th, leaving behind a remarkable legacy for our LGBTIQA plus communities. Phil was a trailblazer, a community advocate and campaigner for AIDS prevention across government, political and community sectors for more than 40 years, and the founding president of Thorn Harbour Health, formerly the Victorian AIDS Council. Phil was, quite simply, a pioneer in exceptionally difficult circumstances. He was the first openly gay man employed by the Victorian Health Department to support AIDS prevention and an inaugural member of the Australian Federation of AIDS Organisations. He was awarded the Order of Australia in 2015 for his dedication to public health and particularly for people living with HIV. He was steadfast in his commitment to these particular passions of his and advocated staunchly for equality. My condolences to his husband Ian, his friends, family and colleagues at Thorn Harbour Health and beyond, and anyone who was lucky enough to connect with him.
Mr Davis with a question, please.
Is again to the Attorney-General. And Attorney, I refer to the now regular referrals by the Director of Public Prosecutions of respected judges to the Judicial College and ask the Attorney, does the Attorney-General concede that judicial independence is inevitably compromised where an activist DPP is in a position to threaten judges who may criticise a prosecution case or simply a judge she dislikes with referral to the Judicial College?
Minister.
First of all, I think it's disgraceful that you would reflect on the DPP in the manner in which you have. Also, you've got your facts wrong. I don't think there's been a complaint made to the Judicial College that I'm aware of, because they don't actually have any responsibility for accepting complaints, because they're an education body. I assume you're referring to the Judicial Commission. Right. So, obviously, I'm aware of the complaints. They've been well ventilated. One of those judges has resigned. The Commission has to cease the investigation because that's the rules as they currently stand. I understand that in relation to the other complaint that's been public, that is an investigation that is ongoing. I don't know about any other existing complaints, but I think that when we as leaders make statements that discourage people from making complaints, that's a really dangerous path for us to be on. I endorse the Law Institute of Victoria's statements, who raised concerns about criticism about anybody making a complaint about inappropriate conduct or any conduct at all. And the fact that you describe somebody as respected, like I have the title of honourable, I don't even really like the title, but that doesn't entitle me be protected because I have a title. If I've done something wrong, a complaint should be made about me, and that should be the same as judges. And I don't care who makes the complaint. If you have an experience with the court, whether you are the DPP, a member of the OPP, a junior barrister, you should not be discouraged from raising those complaints with the appropriate forum, which is the Judicial Commission.
Mr. Davis, supplementary.
Thank you. And I therefore ask, does the Attorney General have full confidence in the DPP, given her now regular referral of judges to the Judicial Commission, sometimes secretly?
Help yourself.
Minister.
We were going all right for a while.
Full confidence.
Ms. Payne with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is for the Minister for Health, Minister Thomas in the other place. This March is Endometriosis Awareness Month, a time when we are encouraged to talk about endometriosis, the pain it causes, and how we can support those living with it. Slowly but surely, endometriosis is getting the attention it deserves. Currently, this government is supporting Deakin researchers to explore the potential use of medicinal cannabis for pain management in people with endometriosis, instead of addictive and harmful opioids. Medicinal cannabis could be the answer to pain for endometriosis and so many other health conditions. So my question is, will the minister make it easier for patients who would otherwise be prescribed opioids to have the option to instead receive medicinal cannabis?
Minister.
Thank Ms. Payne for her question, and I'd be very happy to pass that along to the Minister for Health for a written response in accordance with the standing orders.
Ms. Payne, a supplementary.
Thank you, and I thank the Minister for referral. By way of supplementary, every single one of the 63 participants in the 3-month-long trial will be unable to drive simply because they are medicinal cannabis patients. They are sacrificing their time to help improve government-supported endometriosis research. They will be constantly monitored and taking their medicine as prescribed. Yet this government continues to ignore the research and discriminate against medicinal cannabis patients in a way that is unique from every other prescribed medication. So will the minister commit to ensuring that medicinal cannabis patients in medical studies such as these are empowered with medical exemptions to allow them to drive safely?
Minister.
Thank you, President. And I'll also pass along Ms. Payne's supplementary question for a written answer. Thank you.
Minister Erdogan with the Minister's statement, please.
Thank you, President. I rise today to update the House on the Allan Labor Government's ongoing commitment and investment in early intervention and diversion programs that make us all safer. An important part of this is supporting our vibrant South Sudanese Australian community, including young people through the latest round of the South Sudanese Australian Communities Grants Program. In the upcoming financial year, we'll be allocating a further $400,000 towards projects designed to address the challenges faced by our South Sudanese Australians and provide them with a positive pathway. We're doing this in partnership with the local community organisations, helping to develop their capacity and to improve their communities. This round of grant funding will ensure that crucial initiatives continue to thrive and make a real difference in the lives of our young people. We'll be providing funding to organisations that have shown tremendous success to date, such as the African Youth Initiative, NAS Recovery Centre, NextGen Unite, and Standout Youth Empowerment. These organisations have already engaged almost 500 South Sudanese Australian young people, and this funding will help them reach even more. We're committed to working closely with these organisations to build the sustainability and effectiveness of these programs. That includes providing essential training for these community organisations to ensure they can make the best use of the resources provided to them. As Minister for Youth Justice, I remain steadfast in our commitment to the wellbeing and empowerment of all young South Sudanese Australians. Together, we can build a future filled with promise, opportunity, prosperity for all youth, whatever their background. Tackling the root causes of offending at the early stage is a key part of keeping the community safe, and as a government, we'll always prioritise this. Thank you.
Mr. McCracken with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question is to Minister for Skills and TAFE. Why won't the Minister divulge the number of students who have completed a free TAFE course in the 5 years since the introduction of free TAFE?
Minister?
Yes. It is 5 years. It was happy birthday last parliamentary sitting week. And I have received a number of questions, and I believe that I have answered these questions. And the fact of the matter is, and I'll repeat it again, that there have been completion rates that are 10 points above the national average in terms of Certificate 4 and Diploma. In terms of the completion rates that you continue to be obsessed with, it's in relation to Certificate 1 and 2. And again, for the sake of those that just are refusing to listen and to hear, the fact is that Certificate 1 and 2 mainly deal with pre-apprenticeships to give kids an opportunity, a taste as to what it might be like if they did take that next step and undertake an apprenticeship. And it's for things like English language.
Minister? Sorry, Ms. Mulholland on a point of order.
Relevance. The question was very narrow. The Minister was asked how many completions there have been.
Minister, I'll bring the Minister back to the question.
Thank you. And I believe that I am answering this because what the opposition is attempting to do is to conflate and mislead the House when what they're really wanting to do is to say that Certificate 1 and 2 completions lead to jobs. And we've already said that that isn't necessarily the case. What it does is it leads to further study, President. And we are very proud of what we've been able to do in this area. 157,500 Victorians have enrolled in free TAFE, and we know that the completion rates, particularly at the higher end of the AQF level, have been very high and are in line with university retention rates.
Ms. McCracken with us. Order. Mr. McCracken with a supplementary question, please.
Thank you, President. Is the Minister refusing to provide the number of course completions because the numbers don't look good for the government and free TAFE?
Minister?
Absolutely not.
Ms. Patel with a question, please.
My question is for the Attorney General. An explosive investigation from Farm Transparency Project aired on the 7:30 report last week. It revealed a 30-year-old man had been charged with bestiality involving a pig at Midland Bacon in northern Victoria. This man clearly committed multiple forms of sexual abuse in the vision. However, only his final act of penetration is considered illegal. Currently in Victoria, the definition of bestiality is shockingly weak and does not capture all forms of sexual abuse against animals. Last year, I asked the government to update our bestiality laws to be consistent with states such as New South Wales and Tasmania to ban any act of sexual contact with animals. In light of this evidence, will the government now finally do it?
Minister.
Thank you, President, and I thank Ms. Purcell for her question. And I'll refrain from reflecting on an individual case, but obviously and appropriately, acts of bestiality are illegal in Victoria and are covered under the Crimes Act. I'm aware of the issues that you have raised previously, and you've cited an example today, and I'm certainly open to ways that we can more appropriately respond to this behaviour through the Crimes Act.
Ms. Purcell, supplementary.
Thank you, President, and thank you, Attorney, for your response. We know that there are not only people committing these sexual acts on animals, but watching them too. Over 3,000 sadistic videos of this material are for sale in Australia, including videos crushing to death, burning, drowning, and impaling kittens, puppies, baby chicks, ducklings, pigs, and rabbits. An open source investigation revealed Victorians are consumers of these sexually perverted videos on dark web pornography sites and crush specific websites. It is impossible to know just how big the problem is, but we certainly know that it exists. Will the government also make illegal the production, dissemination, and possession of bestiality and crush materials?
Minister.
Thank you, President. And Ms. Purcell, I appreciate you bringing this to my attention and your call for action. I can't go as far as giving you a firm commitment about exactly how to address this, but it's repugnant and we should act, and I'm pretty happy to work with you on ways that we can address the concerns that you've raised.
Minister Blandford, with the Minister's statement, please.
President, I rise to update the House on the Allan Labor Government's continued commitment to offering children the best start in life. This week is National Playgroup Week, a week all about celebrating and promoting the benefits of playgroups for children, families and communities. I was thrilled to visit the Maidstone Child and Family Centre yesterday for their National Playgroup Week celebration. Families from multiple local supported playgroups as well as community playgroups were in attendance, and it was fantastic to join in their celebrations, particularly the dancing. Parents spoke to me about the benefits playgroup sessions are having for their families. Every year, our government invests more than $11 million to enable around 17,000 parents and their preschoolers attend supported playgroups in 79 local government areas across the state, with local councils like Maribyrnong being the main providers. At supported playgroups, children from birth to school age and their parents enjoy a range of fun play opportunities and activities. Parents also find out about the local services and support networks that exist in their community. Supported playgroups are an evidence-based approach developed by the Parenting Research Centre through an $8 million Victorian Government investment. They are proven to improve outcomes for children, to support parents and to strengthen the early home learning environment for families in particular who are experiencing a form of disadvantage. Some sessions are delivered in language, and there is an opportunity for parents to practice strategies in their own home with one-on-one coaching. The workers even spoke to me about the strategies that they've developed with families who may intermittently attend these playgroups and how they can teach them in their own home to play and learn with their children. There is no more important job than getting children off to a great start in life. Our world-class program, developed right here in Victoria, allows parents to help their babies and toddlers develop language, forge social skills, and become engaged and immersed in the world around them. The Allan Labor Government is proud to help parents, give them the help that they need, close to home and when they need it, through supported playgroups in places like the wonderful Maidstone Child and Family Centre. Thank you, President.
Mr. Mulholland with a question, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. My question is to Minister for Skills and TAFE. Victorian TAFEs have been the worst funded in the country for almost a decade. While class sizes have increased, student learning time has been cut from courses and teacher preparation time has been reduced, conditions the Productivity Commission marks down as inefficient. What does the government plan to do to increase the efficiency in vocational education and training?
Minister.
Well, again, I refute what has been alleged on a number of levels in the question. But in terms of what this government has been doing in relation to building a skills and training system in this state, which was in ruin by the previous government, is for everyone to see. And what we've been able to do is invest in capital. There's hardly a TAFE campus right across this state that hasn't been rebuilt or significantly refurbished. We have also, of course, hired significant numbers of TAFE teachers. The TAFEs have done that, as opposed to what the opposite on the other side of the bench said, where they sacked over 2,000 teachers. We've also, of course, made sure that what is being taught is a lot more relevant to students, and of course teachers are reaping the benefit of that too, because they can see the relevance of their professionalism at work every day. We're making sure that we have got a very effective system that delivers the skills that are required in the labour market. We're making sure that teachers are assured that the TAFE system will continue to be effective. And of course, we have the election commitment of 70% of government funding will be directed towards the TAFE system. So this is a government that is very serious about the structure and the system of a skills system in this state that delivers the skills that are required, not just for the economy, but
but for the individual, and provides them with qualifications that act as a passport for jobs and careers into their future. Right. We are really, really proud of what we've been able to do.
Yeah,
and I think it's just another case getting all these questions that they have not given up their agenda. They continue to despise TAFE and they're not interested in vocational education or training in this state.
Mr. Mulholland, a supplementary question, please.
Thank you, Mr. President. Will the Minister for TAFE ensure that student learning time, teacher preparation time and appropriate class sizes are restored in TAFE courses?
Minister.
Well, President, I'm certainly not going to restore it to the level it was when those opposite were in government, President. What we're about is making sure that we have got good, fair, healthy workplaces where people are contributing in terms of the delivery of their skills and their intellect, and the education that is delivered is of a very high standard. We will continue to do that. It's in our DNA. It's certainly not in the DNA of those opposite.
Order. Order. Mr. Pleielli with a question, please.
Thank you, President. My question today is to the Minister for Mental Health. I think we all watched with concern as the many festivals and events took place recently over that extremely hot Labor Day weekend. As you are no doubt aware, there were multiple serious suspected drug overdoses and hospitalizations across these events, and tragically, one young man has died. In the light of so many drug overdoses at festivals in just these first few months of this year, what more will you do to reduce drug harm at music festivals in our state beyond what you are doing now?
Minister.
Thank you, President. I thank Mr. Pugliese for his question. At the outset, can I offer my condolences to the family of that young man? I can't imagine the heartbreak that they're dealing with right now. And my heart goes out to them, to the family and to the loved ones of that young man. I do want to just caution the member, though, in respect to attributing any cause of death in this circumstance, because it is not for any one of us in here to do that. This is a matter that is being referred to the coroner for investigation, and it's important that we let that process take its course. Of course, the government is very concerned to ensure that our investments and our policy settings are going to have the most impact when it comes to harm minimisation. And we've demonstrated that through record investment in the alcohol and drug services right across the state, including, of course, a program that I know that the member's very well aware of, DanceWise, which is about making sure that people understand the inherent risks associated with taking drugs, but also takes a very educative framework, right, and takes that out to our festivals and to our major events throughout the year. I think it's really important to note also that extreme heat can be a additional risk factor, and of course the Department of Health does issue from time to time, where they see it as appropriate, warnings about heat stress and how that can interact with taking particular forms of illicit drugs. As the member is aware, the government has consistently indicated that we are, at this point in time, we are not looking to change our settings, but we have sought additional advice from the Department of Health, particularly in light of some of the issues that have arisen during this festival season, and we'll continue to take that expert health advice about how we can do everything we can to minimise the risk for all Victorians. We want people to be able to participate in our very rich festival season, but we want them to do it safely, and we'll continue to be really focused on how best to achieve that outcome.
Mr. Pugliese with a supplementary question.
Thank you, President, and I thank the Minister for her response. The Minister referred to DanceWise in her contribution just now, an organisation that were very active during the weekend in question that I've referred to in my substantive question. So by way of supplementary, I'll begin by acknowledging DanceWise do amazing work, mainly off the back of volunteers. They need a significant funding boost if they are able to do more. And while we're talking DanceWise, I've seen this personally at music festivals, people will approach DanceWise volunteers asking them if they can test their drugs. I know that you have been seeking advice on these matters, as you referred to in your contribution just now. So in relation to this advice, when will you report back and offer this government's response?
Minister.
I thank Mr. Puglielli for his supplementary question in relation to the funding that the government provides the DanceWise program. It's quite significant. It's $21 million for that program. So I don't think it's completely accurate to describe it as a volunteer-based program. It does, of course, have, you know, really dedicated volunteers involved in the program, but it does also... It is also provided with support from the government so that it can undertake its important work. In terms of the question around when will we report back on the advice, I'm not in a position to give any indication about a timeframe today, but what I can say is we understand the seriousness of the issues and we are working assiduously with our department on those matters, and we'll take that advice, and when the government has considered that advice, we'll provide the response accordingly.
Minister Tini, Minister's statement, please.
Thank you, President. I rise to update the House on a significant achievement for some of Victoria's top apprentices, trainees and students. 12 Victorians have been selected to represent Australia at World Skills International Competition. This is a fantastic achievement as students and their teachers are recognised for their incredible skills, hard work and dedication. Yeah. As members of Team Australia, or commonly called the Skilleroos, they will join 1,500 participants from over 75 countries in France this September. Over 4 days, competitors will complete practical tasks set by industry and skills experts who will assess their knowledge, competence and employability skills. Competing against and learning from the best of the best from traditional trades such as plumbing and carpentry to emerging industries including cloud computing, mechatronics and graphic design technology. Victoria is producing the top apprentices and trainees in these fields. Victoria proudly hosted the World Skills National Championships in Melbourne last year, and I had the pleasure of meeting so many incredible skilled and young Victorians. This included Star, who will be representing Australia in 3D digital game art, and JC, who is now Australia's first representative in the category of additive manufacturing. Talking to Star and Genevieve, their passion, skill and dedication for their trades was undeniable. And so I'm so pleased that they'll get to join 10 fellow Victorians in shining on an international stage, President. This is further proof that Victoria's vocational education sector is delivering world-class skills. So congratulations to our Victorian Skilleroos. I hope that they bring home the medals and, of course, lots of hard work leading into the training at Lyon.
That ends questions and minister statements. Can I thank Minister Stitt? We'll get both the supplementary and substantive answers for Ms. Payne from the Minister for Health.